Later today, one option is like meeting the first. This is really a job.
Okay. Kind of an easy Christmas warm up. We are game on. No, it's tis the season. Tis the Christmas season. Hey, who was having it yesterday? No, Lily.
All has been started as.
Lily and a note. Who else was having it yesterday?
TJ.
Who?
TJ.
All right, so to get situated today,
we don't have a paper.
Before I even tell you anything else about where we're going, who does not have World War I notes? I had some guys, the guys handed them out.
I put them on the table.
That's good. Everything's bad. I'm missing one today. Got some characters that I need to assign to tell the story of World War I. So we're going to spin the wheel, and I'm going to give, you know, there's some male, there's some female. So depending on who turns up first, I will assign you your role. So drum roll, please. For the star of the show, male or female. Oh, yeah. Hi. Come on up. Kylie, your outfit is, you are Sophie Ferdinand. Put it on.
And
I'm gonna have my characters just go back to their seats.
Mr. Swanson. Gracie's not on there.
We're going pretty roll.
Oh, that Gracie right now. I'm sorry. I made this picker wheel on a day based off, I guess, attendance for that day, and I saved it. And it just always pops up the same. So thank you for telling me that. I'll make sure you get on there. Am I missing anyone else? Please do let me know. I want it to be our whole class, so when I use the wheel in the future, and if someone's absent, obviously they're
staying
on
there.
I'm not on there.
Y'all are not on there.
Ray's not on there.
There we go. I know what it was. It was the same wheel from the last time we picked people, and those people had already been removed. So, fresh wheel. There we go. Kylie is.
Christian's never on there.
Kylie is Sophie Ferdinand. This is you. I will give you this character. You are Sophie Ferdinand. You guys probably don't exactly know who I'm talking about. Yes.
Okay. Magellan Ferdinand's wife.
My name. Hey, Gracie will be my host name.
Who am I missing on the picker wheel? You good now? Are we good now? I never want to leave anybody out. It wasn't on purpose. Okay, spinning the wheel again.
Make sure it lands on me now.
Skinny sliver to land on Eli. Trinity, come on up. Trinity, you are shooter number one. You are shooter number one.
I'm not
hand grenade, holy hand grenade.
Why are you aiming
weapon
for me?
Shooter number one.
I don't have a gun. If I did,
shoot
I would.
Shoot Kylie.
Wow.
Is this like the
shooter? All right, we're still going.
You look like me. Shooter number two.
Oh,
no way.
Brecken.
This is sexist.
Let's go.
Brecken, you are on a. You are shooter number two. So Trinity and Brecken are in cahoots. Brecken, this is you. Trinity, I do not have a photograph of your historical character, but Brecken, you are this fine young looking gentleman. Gabriela Princess. All right, still going? Fabian is the greatest mustache in the history of the world. Archduke Franz Ferdinand. So that's your character. And this is your outfit. Okay. You are second in line for the Austria-Hungarian. Here, Fabian. You gotta finish it out with the hat. Second in line for the Austrian-Hungarian crown and throne, okay? You are, Fabian, you are husband to Sophie. So Sophie and Franz Ferdinand.
I call for a divorce.
Go for a ride. I'm gonna learn more about that. Okay. All right, I need one more gender neutral. Could be anybody.
No.
This is great. Perfect name.
Jordan, you got happy over there.
Glenn, you're the driver. All right, so we are situated with our characters.
Yeah, if you can keep it on.
I'm not.
Another cool aspect about today's class is that some slides, some pictures will be in 3D. So I'm going to hand you some 3D glasses. And not every single picture, but a lot of them will be in 3D.
I'm so excited. I'm going to have it.
So, we have a fun one for today. We are set up. Some of you are wondering why you are who you are.
Can we get a cake,
please? No, I need the glasses back.
Why do people have glasses?
Don't do them.
I'm sorry.
I want to
I'm dripping.
No. I don't want to look this that way.
Everybody got 3D glasses?
Why
are you wearing glasses tonight? All right, and because I'm on the property, I'm going to dim with them two the lights. You can see it's pretty good. All right, so today we are talking. That was not a 3D picture. I'll let you know when they are. Today we are talking about World War One. Does anybody know a nickname for World War One? The Great War. Yes. Well, any other nicknames?
The war. World War.
The First World War. Sure, that's a little obvious.
WW1.
It was actually called the war to end all wars.
I said that like 5 times.
Oh, did they? Okay, I apologize. The war to end all wars. Huh?
Right.
Right. All right. Speak up. Speak up. Use your robust voice. The war to end all wars. Did it?
No.
No. Because by nature of it being called World War One, we can obviously think that there has to be a World War Two. Of course, we know that, right? We have time in history and we can study the past. We know there's a World War Two. But you have to understand, at the time, the world genuinely believed it was fighting the war to end all wars, the war that would settle conflict and bring about peace for the rest of time in history. They really, really believe that. So we got to remember that as we launch into learning more about how they fought, how brutal it was. They thought they were fighting the war to end all wars. Now, I stumbled across this article a while ago. It says, Instagrammer, age 22, says, learning about World War II, but I'm introducing it here. Learning about World War is bad for kids' mental health. Do you think that learning about war is bad for your mental health?
Yes.
Yes.
It shows us what the real war.
Landon says we have to know history to be able to understand what has happened in history, right? We have to know history to not repeat it. Now, I heard the no's, right? No. Oh, wow, look at that. Look at that wimpy boy with his wimpy haircut. Oh, no. Anyone want to say yes, that learning about war is bad for your mental health?
Yes.
No.
Yes. How could be, what are some reasons that it could be? Delaney says blood and guts might be disturbing, right? If there are pictures or videos that are violent and graphic, that might be disturbing.
It could influence me to do bad things.
It could, but don't say me. It could influence someone to maybe be inspired to do equally, harmful things related to war. Hear that? So here is, y'all said several things. Here is that social studies teacher balance. I do not think that it should be harmful to your mental health to learn about history. I do think there's a right way to teach it, and there's that fine line of showing how brutal people were to each other, not necessarily having to show the more graphic sides of that as well. I'll give you this thought as well. There were no safe spaces or trigger warnings for those who had to go out and defend their hometown. What if this Instagrammer was age 22, right? What if you were a 22-year-old and your hometown was being invaded by outside aggressive forces? Do you get a safe space to go cry in a room with a stuffed animal? Do you get a trigger warning? So what I want you to think about is how some people across time and history had to rise to the occasion. Had to defend their hometown, had to defend their way of life, had to stand up against aggression, and they didn't exactly get the chance to prepare for it. They didn't get that safe space or trigger warning. When the bad guys came, the good guys had to stand up and do what's right. So you are of an age where you might have had to take up arms and defend your hometown, right? 14, 15, 16. You're on the younger side of life. Sometimes, I'm a parent, sometimes we still... Parents protect your age bracket, right? We don't really send you out to the wolves and say, figure it out. I want you to think about people who decades earlier, right, you know, 100 years ago, had to step up to, meet the occasion. They didn't exactly have time to prepare for it. It was just the occasion was upon them and they had to meet that. So just some big thoughts to chew on. I will delicately balance how I present information about war, but I want you to know war is real. I think it's a product of a broken world. I think it's a product of sin. You can decide what you think about that. But it is a part of our history, and I think we have to read it, know it, and there's definitely a story arc where we don't want to repeat it. We do not want to repeat the same mistakes societally, right? Now, you might say, I'm one person. How can I fix the world going to war? One person makes one decision that leads to the society making better decisions. So, watch the story arc, see if it ever repeats itself, see if you maybe feel like we're living a story arc that could be leading towards the same. These are the big ideas that we'll tackle over the next couple of days. The Great War, we already talked about it. I love teaching this section. You know, you guys, America, your generation, we're pretty well taught about World War II. Now, there's plenty of nuances that you could study World War II on and on and on and on. But World War II gets the movies, gets the miniseries, gets the books written about it. World War I, I certainly wouldn't call it a forgotten war, but it almost gets overshadowed by World War II. So I really enjoy bringing the information about World War I that you might not have ever read about before. Saving Private Ryan, that's about World War II. Band of Brothers, that's about World War II. And we'll get there. We'll get there after Thanksgiving. But right now we're going to dive into World War I. We've got a pretty fun 4 days ahead of us. I'm going to infuse a lot of these motion pictures. And this is real primary source footage kind of built into these GIFs. We are going to look at a lot of photographs. We're finally at a point in world history where we have photographs. I don't have to show you paintings. I don't have to show you caveman art. I can start to show you photographs. I can start to show you moving pictures. So that's a pretty cool thing about this as well. I already mentioned that it was called The War to End All Wars, and no, it didn't. All right, here's the time. Most of you are already there. You can put your 3D glasses on. This picture right here should be a good example of a 3D picture. We find that it goes best with blue on your right eye. You guys see that? Blue on your right eye, I think, gives us the best. Yeah, blue goes on your right eye. Red on your right eye gives you a headache. Blue should go on your right eye. I've done this with a couple classes now. Blue goes on your right eye. You see that picture right there?
It looks the same.
Blue should be on your right eye. There's some depth to it. It should show you. You should see some depth. So what you're seeing here, I won't explain every single picture in like crazy amount of depth. What you're seeing here is a military cemetery overseas with American dead, dead American soldiers. Sometimes, now not recently, Iraq and Afghanistan, we went to great lengths to bring bodies home, to bring fallen soldiers home so they could be buried wherever their family chooses. But sometimes, when we have mass casualties, hundreds or thousands of dead in one battle, we had to bury them where they were. So there are a lot of Americans buried in Europe, buried overseas. Technically, that ground is considered an American military cemetery. Technically, it's considered American soil, but realistically, it is over in Europe. So just one example of the rows and rows of cemetery gravestones from World War I dead. I spent a lot of time making that one. All right, we're going to talk about the causes of World War I, and this is what your notes will follow. M-A-I-N-N, a perfectly little arranged acronym for the causes of World War I, the main causes of World War I. Now, I want you to understand about M-A-I-N-N, these are long-term causes. These are the causes that were boiling up for decades before the war actually started. Then we'll go M-A-I-N-N as those long-term causes. Then I will tell you the immediate cause, the straw that broke the camel's back, if you will, that led the world into war. So you can write these. I'll give you the M-A-I-N-N, and then we're going to peel them back one at a time. M is militarism. A is alliances. I is imperialism. And N is nationalism. So on your notes, you have the M-A-I-N-N. Write each of these words. Militarism, alliances, imperialism, and nationalism. The picture on the screen is a little bit 3D. It's a fighting position, a bunker from the World War I front.
Yeah, I don't see that. I'm
3D.
That picture's a little more jumbled. There's some better ones. Same thing here. Militarism, alliances, imperialism, nationalism. Just showing you this picture. We got those four words?
Yes.
Should be easy to capture the four words. All right. I'm going to talk through them in order. What is militarism? What do you even think? What's the root word there?
Military.
Okay. Military. Sure looks a whole lot like military. Militarism is characterized as an arms race between countries. Now, not a nuclear arms race. That is the next step that we will talk about inside of the Cold War, but a conventional arms race. I have more guns than you. I have more bullets than you. I have sharper bayonets than you. These countries had the biggest stockpiles. Glorification of war. You know, we love uniforms. We love medals. We love going onto the battlefield and showing that we are stronger than you. In Europe, a lot of these nations shared borders that they were of their rivals. it would almost be like, now let me say this carefully, but it would almost be like how Georgia and Florida has a sports rivalry. We're not going to go invade Florida. They're not going to come invade us. But we share a border. We have a rivalry. We talk smack to each other, right? Georgia, Florida, Alabama, right? Well, these countries in Europe, there were many countries, and they shared borders. And in fact, you know what? A lot of these monarchs, a lot of the kings and princes, they were actually intra-related. There's a whole lot of like second and third cousin removed going on. So it's almost a family affair. And these countries wanted to be better than their neighbor. So an arms race, a glorification of war, and just the idea that we wanted to be the most powerful kid on the block. We expressed that through sports, I think, right? We got rivalries with neighboring counties. They expressed it through war. Lily's like, I don't care. You know, Pearson beat us. It doesn't bother me.
No, it's just like we lost
every game. Okay. Okay, well, yeah, we're that country that loses every game. All right, so militarism. Additionally, we're in a time period where there's a whole lot of new technology available. So everybody wanted to have that best new piece of technology. Today, I'm not going to go super in-depth on the new technologies. I will tomorrow. And I'm going to show you a whole lot of pictures as it relates to the new technology. What do you think you see on the screen there?
A tank.
A very early tank. Not exactly like the main battle tank you would see coming out of the American motor pool these days, right? An Abrams tank. What do you think this tank was good for? Climbing over trenches. Okay, so I haven't gone in depth on trench warfare yet. That is one of the major tactics that gets used in World War I. Digging into the ground, staring at each other from 50 to 100 yards away, climbing out of the trenches, trying to take over your enemy's trenches. We'll talk trench lines tomorrow, but it is notable that the tank was designed to overcome the trench warfare, to climb over these trenches. It was not fast. It was not. It did not have the best of guns mounted on it, but it was a armored hunk of metal that could navigate the battlefield and keep the people inside of it safe. Machine gun is a major new piece of technology that comes out of World War I. So instead of one shot, you know, ramming the bullet down the muzzle of your rifle, pouring the powder in, you know, Revolutionary War, Civil War style. Well, now we have machine guns where you can fire hundreds of bullets a minute. Who came up with who was the first to design a machine gun?
Leonardo
da Vinci is right. So again, I'll talk in depth about technology tomorrow. I'm really not trying to get ahead of myself here. Just suffice it to say there's a variety of new technologies that led to this militarism. Pretty good picture here shows a 3D picture. Show soldiers cleaning their machine guns, disassembling them, making sure there's not dirt on them. Other technology you might think about, there are planes and submarines. Planes and submarines are making an appearance in World War I as well. So M is for militarism. We want to be better than you. A is for alliances. If you raise your hand if you have an alliance with someone right now in your life. What is an alliance? An agreement, okay. I think these four back here have an alliance with each other. They're willing to fight anyone else who might try to break into their group. Just an example.
We're very excited.
Just an example. I had students. Here's a pretty good example as well. I don't know if this is your story, but teaching this class in the past, someone said it was a softball girl from a different county. Yeah, she came from a different county. She said, "Yeah, if I got hit by a pitch in a game, my girl from a different school, she's gonna try to hit that other team back the next time they see each other." So even though they're not on the same team, that's an alliance. So you know, you see that in baseball. You know, I'll just take the Houston Astros, right? Everybody wants to throw up the Houston Astros because they cheated in 2017, right?
And in 2021.
My example is falling flat. I apologize for that. An alliance is an agreement between each other. So in World War I, agreements to aid each other if attacked. Most nations had a secret alliance with their neighbor. But you really didn't know who was on what team. These alliances weren't publicly stated very well or very often. However, we see alliances become very important once that first punch is thrown. Really good example, maybe this one will be better. An example would be like a schoolyard fight or, not anything you guys know about, but a bar fight. If one person gets involved, you know, starts swinging, all of a sudden you have everybody in the schoolyard or everybody in the bar swinging and fighting, and maybe we don't know why, or maybe we don't know who we're punching, but man, there's a fight going on, and I want to be a part of it. Well, this express in World War I time frame, this is expressed through alliances, and the two sides are called the Allies and the Central Powers. Allies and the Central Powers. I would say the so-called good guys are the Allies, and that is in red, Britain, France, and Russia. The so-called bad guys are in blue. Those are the Central Powers. What are they called in World War II? Who are the bad guys in World War II? The Axis. So don't get it confused with that, right? In World War I, our names are slightly different. Allies, good guys. Axis, bad guys. And you can see that, you can see the crossover, right? This is a Venn diagram. Gets a little confusing as you look at it. That's actually the point. It's confusing who was allied with who. Bulgaria and Serbia, kind of the wild cards in the middle. Suffice it to say, these two teams, generally two teams develop with a couple of wild card players on the outside as well. Here's a little bit of a cleaner list. The Central Powers, they were called the Triple Alliance. The big three being Germany, Austria, Hungary, and Italy. Got a couple of other smaller players in there as well. And then the Triple Entente, Entente means agreement, so a three-way agreement. They are the Allied powers, and the big three being Russia, Great Britain, and France. How does the United States get involved? Yeah, plot twist, much later, right? The United States is not involved until much later. You do see us on the side of Russia, Great Britain, and France. What's that? Why are we always late to the wars? That is a fantastic question that I hope I will be able to point out to you next time. What's notable about Italy?
They switch teams
is a great way to say it, Landon. Yeah, halfway through the war, they leave the losing side. They join the winning side. Now, there's more reasons to it than that, but Italy switches teams halfway through the war. Here is a picture that shows all the flags. So you look around the room and you see all the flags, and no, I can't name them all because there's all these small, nuanced countries that I don't have memorized. But this shows how the empire model and imperialism got so many other countries involved. Because to say that the UK is involved is to also say that Australia and New Zealand and South Africa and Canada and India and Newfoundland is involved. The British Empire, have you ever noticed how often the Union Jack is on other flags as well? That's because those countries are formerly of the British Empire. Same thing on the German Empire. Now, there is no German Empire today, but at the time, the German Empire included all of those other countries as well, Bavaria, Prussia, Saxony, Württemberg. So the German Empire encompassed a whole lot of other countries as well. That's how one of these daddy countries getting involved gets five or six of their other allied countries involved as well. Now, at this time, what I want on your notes, you see you got your map there, you got your map pretty big. Everybody's going to need three colors. So if you have your own colors, great. If not, here is a set of colored pencils you can come and grab from. Everybody's going to need three different colors, just three different ones, whatever color scheme you want to come up with. Three different colors, whatever color scheme you want to come up with. Yes. Yes, you are.
I'm not wearing it. I gave the drop to Lily. I don't want to be rich.
All right, everybody have three colors yet? We're going to be sharpening. Let's get through this map and this coloring. We'll take our bathroom break. And yeah, you gotta go to the bathroom in your costume.
No,
I can't.
I'll go with
this. Where's my boy today?
I'll go with this. No, I'm not. I can't
wait. What are you doing?
Oh, Julia's gonna fight you for your costume.
What?
Julia's gonna fight you for your costume.
Landon doesn't want him to be the kid.
All right, while you're finishing up your sharpening, so pick one color. On the screen it's blue, but pick one color. On your key, color it in with that color under central powers, and then make the map look like that. Those are the central powers. You can see it goes over Germany, Austria-Hungary, to the lower right, the Ottoman Empire. If you need to get closer to look, that's fine. This blob of blue, or whatever color you choose, these are the central powers. They are so named because they are in the center of Europe. Centrally located in Europe. Remember, we're on the A of Maine. We're talking about alliances. So this color that goes over, it's more than just one country, right? This color blob that goes over several countries, these are the countries that are in an alliance together. I'll advance the slide here for whatever pace you're at. The allies are going to be in red, and so pick a second color, whatever that is for you. Put it on the key, and then color in what you see on the screen as red. Make that your second color, the allied powers. What I hope you'll notice is how amorphous and blob-like these alliances are. There's not a front line. There's not a clean cut. To the west is one team, to the east is the other team. These alliances blob all over each other, and they share a border with each other. And clearly, if we're interested in fighting each other, because we're militaristic, we have alliances, maybe even secret alliances with each other. Clearly, we're about to have a fight on our hands based off of how these lines are drawn. Some countries will remain neutral, and they are white. The easy thing to do would be leave it as white. That's actually not your third color. So you go ahead and leave the neutral countries as white. Your third color is going to be the so-called Balkan countries. And the Balkans are a powder keg. The Balkans are going to be where the spark is lit and the explosion happens. So similar to the yellow shape there, I want you to make an explosive looking shape, boom, over the Balkan countries, because the Balkans are the powder keg of Europe. And we are going to see how the Balkans are become responsible for the whole war kicking off anyway. So you should have your three colors. White is the freebie. White is neutral. Central ally and Balkans with an explosion. Make it a little bit more visual for y'all, drawing on the map so you can see who belongs to what team. Some of you are quick colors, and some of you are doing this sweet little outline and shade and artistic thing. Yeah, that's cool. Go ahead and give you another minute to tidy up your colors, and then we'll go to the restroom. If you want to keep coloring after we get back, that is fine. But I'm just going to give us about one more minute before we go to the restroom. Thank you.
Where's my country from? What country?
So what?
Where's my country from?
The Balkans. You are the powder keg.
It's the bird. That was my
All right, go ahead and find that pause point. We'll go to the restroom, get your wiggles out, and come on back. We got more of the story to tell.
I'm not wearing my hat.
Let's go.
Come on, you guys. Let's go.
Thank you. perceptive.
You're like a taller.
I'm not taller than you, dude.
No, you're cocoa, though.
We're all about non-choppies.
I am struggling with, sometimes if I don't take my Claritin like right on time every day, or I skip a day, I start to have a bad allergies day after that. So I'm struggling a little bit right now.
Is that why your eyes are Claritin?
I don't think I took my Claritin yesterday. So what I'm asking you is to please bear with me, make it easy on me to just present this information without being extra. I love our back and forth, but this is a good class. This is a good chunk of information. Please let me get to it. You can see we got some characters who have to present their story in just a few minutes. So hang in there, Jayla.
Which one are you talking?
Are you great?
Yes, you are.
Yes. Thank you. Okay, here we go. So you have this, you have the key colored. I hope you can see that the way that these countries border each other is clearly going to lead to some boundary issues and fighting issues, right? Everybody being on different teams with the central powers, you know, kind of touching both sides of the allied powers, and then the Balkan powder keg. We are clearly set up to have ourselves a little scuffle. Here's another map that shows it pretty well. I mean, you guys just colored it yourself, but this extends a little bit more into the Middle East with the Ottoman Empire as well. Okay, so that's alliances. Okay, hang on to the Balkan powder keg. I'm going to get to the explosive point here in just a second. I for imperialism. Imperialism is a competition for colonies. A really good example is how the British tried to own everybody across the 1600s, 1700s, and 1800s. We, America itself, is a product of imperialism and colonialism. But the idea at this point was that each parent country, that's the phrase I'm going to keep using, right? The mommy country, the daddy country, each parent country wanted to gobble up smaller countries all around the world for a lot of reasons. You could have a port city in Africa. You could have an airport in Asia. You can have trade partners with all your colonies. So there's a lot of reasons to want to spread all around the country. And this actually led to many smaller wars over territory. So even though we think of World War I being mostly in Europe, the trenches in Europe, there's also these smaller wars happening all over the world as well between imperial powers, between empires. And that is how it really truly becomes a world war. Now, we're not going to super focus on any of these tinier conflicts. We're actually not going to focus on any of these tinier conflicts, but I just want you to know that they are out there. The political cartoon's pretty good. U.S. history, I'm trying to give you a step into U.S. history. We analyze a lot of political cartoons. So every time you look at a cartoon, I've already taught your brain to do this, you should start with the 5 W's. Who's it talking about? Where are they, you know, where is it depicting? What are they doing, when, what time period? So with that as a starting point, just go ahead and somebody tell me what you think's going on in this political cartoon.
So England wants to take all the
England, it's clearly labeled in the middle. What is it, kind of, what, if that was an animal, what's it depicted as?
Octopus.
Looks like an octopus, but at the end of each tentacle, What is it?
A hand.
Okay, it's a hand. So would you say that England is trying to have a hand in all of these other countries and their affairs? Pretty simple to break this one down. Like I said, in U.S. history, we'll do a lot of political cartoons and how they are relevant to whatever we're talking about at the time. A big reason we do that is, one, these are the memes of yesteryear. Okay, you guys can go to your meme generator apps, and there's all the funny memes. You guys can make a point with a meme. Well, guess what? Political cartoons were the memes of 100 years ago. So it's really important to try to understand what the authors were saying and how it's culturally relevant. So a lot of reasons to dissect political cartoons. I just want to point out that we'll do a lot of that in U.S. history. Nationalism. The N is nationalism. Nationalism primarily led to a lot of French and German border conflicts. There's actually a portion of the border where both sides wanted to claim extra land, and it was kind of along ethnic lines. Now, it's really easy to draw a national boundary if there's a mountain range there, or if there's a river that kind of cuts you off and you can clearly say this is our border. It's a whole lot harder to do when there's ethnicities that might float either side. Like, I'm a French national, but I'm inside of the German border. I don't really feel like I belong to Germany. I feel like my ethnicity belongs to France. So French and Germany, they had a lot of border conflicts based off of ethnicity. Nationalism is also related to national pride. My country is better than your country. My uniforms look better than your uniforms. We have cleaner rifles than you have. Our king can out bench press your king, right? My dad can beat up your dad. Nationalism is to try to say that my country is better than yours. Now, super fine line here. Nationalism could be referred to as patriotism. Is patriotism a bad thing? We generally say to be patriotic is a good thing. I love my country, and that's fine. Nationalism can take an extreme slant, however, and extreme nationalism is not I love my country only, but it's I hate your country. That's when nationalism becomes extreme, and that's when it becomes bad. You can love your country, you want to call yourself a nationalist, you're proud of your country, you're a patriot, that's good. But the extreme side of that would be to turn that statement outward and say, I love my country and I hate your country. This leads to the rivalries that we're going to see expressed all throughout World War II. Basic, and then the picture here, what do you see nationalism? Where's nationalism leading the people? Straight off a cliff. So clearly the author here is trying to say that nationalism could take you straight off a cliff. Obviously, that would harm you and your country. So fine line between patriotism and maybe positive nationalism and extreme or hateful nationalism that leads to destruction. So that's M-A-I-N. Militarism, alliances, imperialism, and nationalism leads us to the Balkan powder keg. You've already drawn this on your map. You gave it the explosion. What's going to happen in the powder keg of the Balkans is going to be the real tipping point that actually leads us to war. Remember, M-A-I-N-N, those were those long-term buildups, the decades-long buildup of the military, the decade-long arrangement of alliances. M-A-I-N-N, those are long-term causes. We also have one immediate cause that launches the region and thus the world into war, and this is what we are going to depict right now. So, if you're a character, if I pulled your name and gave you a costume, put your costume on, bring your weapons up. Whether I gave you a gun or a hand grenade, whatever, come on up. Ladies here, let me push this back as far as I can. Y'all come on up to the front of the room. This is where I want you to be. I'm going to introduce our characters, and then I'm going to, this is where you got to hang with me. I'm going to be the narrator, so to speak, and these characters are going to have to do what I tell them to do as we act all of this out. So, Shooter one and shooter two, back corner. You guys are planning your devious licks right now. Devious,
no.
What y'all call it? Is that what it's called, right? Y'all are planning your devious licks right now, okay? Driver man, you are, can I just go back a little bit for you? You are driving, so I want you to be, Man is the driver.
Thank you.
Clearly he looks like a driver, right?
I need to roll a chair.
Okay. Archduke friends, where's your paper? Grab your paper. Grab your picture paper. Fabian is Archduke Franz Ferdinand. Now show the class your picture. Turn around, show the class. Does he resemble? What's he missing? What's he really missing? He's really missing an epic mustache. He's missing an epic mustache, but I can't fix that necessarily, so we just gotta roll with it, right? Baby, and I can't grow a mustache like that either. It's all good. Put your hat back on. Fabian, as Archduke Franz Ferdinand, he is second in line. I take that back. He is next in line to be the prince, the king of Austria-Hungary. He's the prince of Austria-Hungary. He's called an archduke. He is next in line to be the king of Austria-Hungary. Austria-Hungary is a dominant power in the region, and they are one of the, they are the daddy of Serbia. Okay? They are the imperial overlord of a smaller country called Serbia. Well, Serbia doesn't really like the fact that Austria-Hungary is in charge of it. Some might like that, right? Just like there were some loyalists in America that said, hey, we'll just deal with the king. But most of them did not. Most Serbians wanted Serbian independence. And you two are a member of a terrorist organization that wants Serbian independence. So these two over here, set the scene right here, they're members of a terrorist group called the Black Hand. You two, you are 19 years old. You are making big decisions at age 19, right? You're going to commit the crime of the century at age 19. So sometimes young people make bad decisions because they don't have the mental maturity to kind of really think through the second and third order effects of their decisions. So you two over here, you are about to commit the crime of the century at age 19. You are members of the Black Hand. Now, Brecken, she's going to be shooter number one. No, Trinity, shooter number one. Trinity is unnamed, okay? We do not know her name. I do not know her name in history. I don't have a picture of her, but she's important because she's shooter number one. Brecken is shooter number two. Brecken, you're a dude. Your name is Gavrilo Princep. So this is Gavrilo Princep. He is the one who will really light the match that sparks the powder keg that becomes World War One. So I've set them up. Kylie, who are you? Kind of missed you. Sophia Ferdinand, Franz Ferdinand's wife. And this is a picture of them on the day that they would die. Okay, this picture is taken hours before they would both die. Brecky did it. This picture was taken hours before they would both die in Serbia. So now that the scene in Landon is just the driver. Just the driver, that's it. Now that the scene has been set, here's what they're going to do. These two, they are going to Serbia to wave and blow kisses and smile and just try to show the people they care about them. Remember, the Serbians don't really like their overlords. So, Fabian, you're trying to connect with the people, right? You're trying to show them that you care. And the way they do this is in an open-top vehicle, a convertible, basically. They ride along a parade route, waving, blowing kisses, everything I just said, trying to show the people that they care. So y'all get situated in a car type setup here. Landon's the driver. You got to put your hands out like you're driving. You ready? Now you're in an open top vehicle and you're waving. So kind of go slowly. You're driving along the parade route. Talk to your people.
Hello.
You guys suck.
So, at this time, the Black Hand, the terrorist group, they are aware of the parade route. Okay? The parade route got published in the newspaper that morning. So they're like, ha, 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 I know what we can do. We can assassinate the Archduke. We hate Austria-Hungary so much, we're going to assassinate the next in line to be the king. So this is how they do it. Trinity, as shooter number one, take a step forward.
Okay.
Trinity uses a hand grenade, okay, the holy hand grenade, and she rolls it underneath their vehicle. So roll the hand grenade underneath their vehicle. Vehicle, keep on driving. Drive to the end of the room. Trinity, what'd you forget?
Pull the pin.
No, she pulled the pin, but she,
they're moving, though.
But she forgot that there was about a 10-second delay on the grenade. They are moving, Lily said. That's correct. So this grenade, this hand grenade, boom!
Oh, shit. It's the car behind him. It's the car behind him. You two, speed off. Landon, speed off. To the back of the room. The Archduke and his wife, they speed off. There is a vehicle, not represented by anyone here, there is a vehicle where there are people that are hurt. So Trinity's hand grenade did hurt somebody. Trinity, they're on to you. They saw you do it. Come towards me. She's running away. She's making her getaway. Her getaway. Pause. Trinity did not expect to survive this day. As shooter number one, she expects to die at some point on this day. She's a little bit of a suicide attacker in that regard. Trinity takes a caplet of poison called cyanide. Take a little pill. She takes a cyanide caplet that should have been a suicide pill. It should have killed her, right? She said, I'm going to die before they take me alive. I ain't going to jail. Guess what? You took a bad batch of cyanide, and it just gave you a stomachache. So she can't kill the Archduke. She can't even kill herself well. What are you going to do now? You're trying to get away from the authorities. You know what? I probably should have actually taken a gun from you. You're trying to get away from the authorities. You have no more weapons. But guess what? There's a river right there.
She's going to drown herself.
Go jump into the river.
Yes,
ma'am.
Try to
stop. Jump.
There we go.
Guess what? It's 4 inches deep. You can't even kill yourself the way you want. Trinity is arrested and goes to jail. Go ahead and go right there. So shooter number one, completely unsuccessful. An absolute failure. Does not kill the Archduke. Can't take good cyanide and jumps into a 4-inch deep body of water. And I guess you didn't actually sniff up the water. I don't know. Trinity goes to jail because she was an unsuccessful criminal. She didn't do anything right at all. Archduke, you have been targeted. You know that there are people out there trying to kill you. What do you do next?
Go home.
Who raised your? Who would say they let's go home? The wisdom of the wife, Sophia, says let's go home. Gracie, what are you saying?
I said that you're
going to
lead them to your house.
Oh, okay. So if you go home, that would lead them to your house, and they could attack you there. What else would you do? What else might you do? Go into exile, right? Just go into hiding.
No, get my guards.
Get your guards. Yeah, Landon. So Landon, come back up front. Be the driver again. Just be situated. Brandon, how about you come right over here? Are you ready? Your gun ready?
He's gonna shoot you.
Here's what they do. You ready for it? Here's what they do. They continue the parade. They continue the parade on the exact same route as previously published. So, boom, oh no, guess what? Get back to it, right? Landon, start driving. Waving. Boom. I know you guys just tried to kill me, but hi. Gabrielo Princep. Homeboy here is so frustrated that shooter number one didn't do the job that you know what he does? He goes to get a sandwich. Goes to a sandwich shop. This sandwich shop just so happens to be on the parade route. So while you're eating your feelings, I'm so angry that we didn't kill the Archduke, guess what? He appears right in front of you. This convoy, this vehicle parade, appears right in front of shooter number two. So slowly, drive on by. Gavrilo, one shot to the wife, one shot to the Archduke. Die. Blood. And scene. All right, claps for our participants. Go ahead and take your seat. Thank you. That almost felt anticlimactic. Fabian.
You saw me.
Take a seat. As long as the wall makes us out. All right, so we lifted out a little bit.
What happens is, yes, one shot to Sophia, one shot to the Archduke, and they both die. So Archduke, Franz Ferdinand, I'm going to click through these slides because I basically already told you the whole story, right? Archduke Franz Ferdinand is assassinated. This one's not pretty. What you can see here, there's no photography of the moment, right? Because nobody was expecting it to happen. There's a variety of pictures that show what might have happened, you know, in that moment. Obviously, that is Gavrilo, and he shoots Sophia. He shoots Franz, one shot each. Guess what? Fabian, your nice little outfit, it still exists in the world today. It is on display, even full of the Archduke's blood at a particular museum. I've not seen it with my own eyes, but I know it exists. So what we have here is that Austria declares war on Serbia, because of course they do. We can't just have the Serbians going around shooting our heirs to the throne. And suffice it to say, I'm going to tell you the order here a little bit. All the allies jump in on both sides. And here's the best comparison. Little brother got into a bar fight, but all the big brothers had to come in and help him out. So one punch, one shot, two shots really, right? One for the man, one for the woman. These are the shots that started the world war. And you can see the newspaper heading there. Heir to Austria's throne is slain with his wife, a Bosnian Serbian youth, to avenge the seizure of his country. Got a couple more pictures here. This is the man, Franz Ferdinand, the most epic mustache of our time. This is him and his wife. And so Kylie was showing you this picture, but now it's a little larger for you to see. This photograph was taken hours before their death. This was on their parade. You can see they're in an open top convertible. They're shaking hands, kissing babies, trying to be amongst the people. And wouldn't you know it, because it's an open top convertible, they are an easy target for assassination. Sounds like what?
JFK.
Sounds like JFK. Maybe people should stop riding in open top convertibles, is what I would say, right?
And making the parade route public.
That's right. Here's Gavrilo. So a little bit more about Gavrilo. I'll finish up his thoughts here. He was age 19 when he did it. Like I said, a lot of times young people make foolish decisions, or they don't consider the consequences of their actions. Gavrilo, what do you think happened to Gavrilo? He was arrested, so he did not kill himself. He was arrested. What do you think would be a suitable punishment for him?
Death?
Execution? You know what? He was too young to get the death penalty. In Serbia, you have to be 20 years old to be eligible at this time, to be eligible for the death penalty. He's only 19. So he is sentenced to 20 years in prison. But guess what? He dies 3 years later of tuberculosis. He dies before the war that he started is over. So he never really even sees the end of the freedom that he was trying to fight for, the cause that he was trying to advance. He dies in prison at age 23 before the war is even over. So I'll cut really to the end here. A lot of the allies are pulled into the war because of this one event. What started with two bullets and two dead people leads to 40 million deaths around the world. 40 million people died throughout World War I, and arguably it started because of this immediate cause, the assassination of the Archduke. Pretty cute little comic strip here. I'm not going to walk through it. If you want to look at Google Classroom when I post it, you're certainly welcome to do that. But pretty good description of the what we just acted out. Kind of talked about how if World War I was a bar fight, everybody starts to get involved. And this is another really good political cartoon that shows everybody pointing at everybody. And it's called The Crime of the Ages, Who Did It? Because arguably the big countries are involved. The big countries declare war on each other. But really, it's almost like a whodunit. Everybody's pointing at everybody else because of a whole lot of blame being passed around. I'll probably pay attention to this slide for a second. This is a slide I should have shown a little bit earlier. So World War I really kicks off in seven steps. Step one is what we just lived out. The Serbian nationalist, that's Gavrilo, that was Brecken. This 19-year-old kills the Archduke and his wife. Austria declares war on Serbia. You have to, right? You can't have Serbians going around killing your archdukes. Well, Germany, who's the big daddy, supports Austria. Oh, shoot. Russia says, guess what? Our alliance is with Serbia, and Germany's not going to go throw their weight around without us getting involved, too. Russia supports Serbia. Germany says, I got you. Well, I'm going to declare war on Russia, and since we're there, how about France as well? Germany declares war two in a row. And then Great Britain, from the back of the bar, that's why I say it's like a bar fight, Great Britain says, okay, Germany, you can't do that without us getting involved, so now we're involved, too. And you can see this is nothing you need to memorize. You can, you know, you're not going to have to know who declared war and in what order. But the best description is it's like a domino effect. As soon as one person got involved, they all got involved, and now we have a world at war. Who haven't we talked about yet?
America.
America, right? So what is America doing amidst all this?
Chilling.
Chill. I like the word chilling. You got a more formal word for it?
Staying neutral.
Staying neutral. And if you stay all the way by yourself, what's that? Hang on to that. If I'm all by myself, a little bit of a COVID analogy here. If I'm going to be by myself and away from the rest of you, what is it called?
Quarantine.
Isolation. Quarantine is a fair word, especially as I talk about COVID, but Colin said it best. America had an isolationist attitude. The attitude was, hey, that's hashtag Europe's problem. Guess what? There's a whole ocean between us. Why in the world would we get involved with the bar fight that's happening in Europe? It doesn't affect us. This is, I'll kind of introduce some U.S. history to you here as well. George Washington established that precedent when he was president. He said, do not get entangled in foreign affairs if you can help it. So for a long time, America really stayed with that attitude. We are not going to get involved in Europe's problems because those are Europe's problems and there's a whole ocean between us. So there's really no reason for America to get involved in this whole European conflict until, what do you think the big until is? Colin says something pretty specific. Here's the until I'm looking for. Until something does affect us, right? We stay isolated and isolationist until something does affect us. So most of America is isolationist. Here's the words for you. I should have revealed these earlier. Most of America is isolationist. President at the time is Woodrow Wilson. Woodrow Wilson, he runs for re-election on the campaign that he kept us out of the war, right? He was president prior to all this happening. In his re-election campaign, his four-year mark where he's running for re-election, it was he kept us out of the war. People were so proud to be out of the war, to be not involved in Europe's conflicts, that they re-elected Woodrow Wilson on the idea that he kept us out of the war and he was going to keep us out of the war. And he did keep us out of the war until he got us involved in the war. Right? He said his campaign promise was so heartfelt that he goes on and actually gets us involved in the war pretty shortly thereafter. You got this written down? Got this written down real quick? So Colin said it. I think Ray said it. I think Christian has a conspiracy theory about it. I'm not sure. The first thing that happens that starts to draw America into the war is called the sinking of the Lusitania. This is a newspaper article. Obviously, you see the headline, Lusitania. Comparable to the Titanic in that it was a luxury cruise liner. This was not a military ship. This was not a Navy ship. This ship did not have guns on it. But the accusation was that it was carrying war supplies. And the Germans at this time are involved in something called unrestricted submarine warfare. One, submarines are a new piece of technology. Submarines are new to the battlefield, and people are kind of figuring out how they work. How can we use them? How can it help us win wars? Two, Germany started to say any ship in the Atlantic Ocean is involved in the war effort because guess what? They're probably, even if they're posing as a cruise ship, they're probably carrying war supplies. So if it's not our ship, if it's not a German ship, we are going to sink it. And that is called unrestricted. It means they didn't have any boundaries on themselves. Unrestricted submarine warfare. And because of unrestricted submarine warfare, this passenger ship is sunk 1,000 people die, 130 Americans die. So now we can't stay isolated because we have American civilians dying, to include some pretty rich people. Okay, being a luxury cruise liner, there are some richies involved. There are some rich people on the ship. And you know what? Money can't save you from a submarine. When your ship goes down, it doesn't matter how much money you have, you're going to drown right alongside of it. So 130 people, Americans and rich people at that, died in the sinking of the Lusitania. Really good picture here. Obviously, it's a sketch, not a photograph, but it shows how the submarine is lurking in the deeps. And then the unsuspecting luxury cruise liner gets hit by a torpedo and sinks. This is a fantastic graphic here that I'm not going to go into. I'm not going to look at every little thing there. But you can see it all happened pretty fast. The Lusitania sunk in 18 minutes. It sunk into 91 meters of water, which that's actually a pretty shallow sinking. A lot of ships are a lot deeper underneath the ocean than that. 1,200 people drowned total, and it says 128 people drowned from the United States, 128 Americans. This happens on May 7th, 1915. So, man, I should have said the date previously. The whole Gavrilo Princip thing, the whole thing we acted out, that was June 28th of 1914. And you should associate World War I with 1914 to 1918. Generally speaking, a four-year war, 1914 to 1918. Well, the Lusitania is hit in 1915. You guys have probably been waiting for these words. Germany declares unrestricted submarine warfare, sunk by a German U-boat. U-boat means submarine. The U stands for underwater. So if you ever hear that phrase, it's pretty much the same thing as a submarine. It just means an underwater boat. Kills 1,000 people, 130 Americans. Here's what the president says. Woodrow Wilson does not want to get involved in this European conflict, but he can't, at this point, can't ignore the fact that Americans have been targeted. He says Germany must apologize. They must stop targeting peaceful ships, as in they must stop this unrestricted submarine warfare. If it's a Navy ship, if it's a warship, we get it, right? Warships can attack warships. But you got to stop targeting civilian ships and cargo ships and peaceful ships. If this happens, Germany apologizes, Germany stops targeting peaceful ships, America will stay neutral. Well, Germany did not want America involved in the war, so they agreed this. Germany offers a loose apology, and they back off on the unrestricted submarine warfare. So it seems like, for the time being, America will stay out of the war. This is really important, because the Lusitania, the sinking of the Lusitania, is often called, mistakenly called, the reason America got involved in the war. It is a reason that walked us closer to the war, but it is not the reason. The reason comes a couple years later, and the easiest thing to think about is we didn't get involved in the war until 1917, so you can't really say that this thing that happened in 1915 is what drew us into the war. The second thing that happens, and I would say, history would say, this is what drew America into the war, is called the Zimmerman Telegram. So I'll put the words on the screen so you can start writing them down. The Zimmerman Telegram was a communication that was intercepted by American code breakers, code talkers. It was sent from Germany to Mexico. And what it said was, it said to the Mexicans, hey Mexico, if you invade the United States from the north, get America involved in the war in North America, and thus keep them out of the war in Europe, When we win the war, we will give back to you California, Arizona, New Mexico, and all the territory that you previously lost to the United States. Now that's diving into U.S. history a little bit. You got to think about the Mexican-American wars and how territory was snatched from Mexico previously. But this is an attempt to get Mexico to attack America from the south. Now, tell me, did Mexico attack America from the south? Most of you know that that did not happen, right? We don't have a Mexican-American battle in the 1920s. But Germany was trying to get Mexico to attack from the north on the promise that Germany would give territory back to Mexico. Well, when this is intercepted, and this is what it actually looks like, right? It's just a bunch of numbers. I can't read that, but a bunch of smarter people than me This is why math matters, okay? Because they use math and algorithms and all the junk you guys complain about in algebra class to try to figure, to actually crack the code on these numbers. And the numbers got translated into words, and then the words actually point this out. So I'm going to read this to you. We make Mexico a proposal of alliance on the following basis. If we make war together, we'll make peace together. And an understanding on our part is that Mexico will reconquer territory lost in Texas, New Mexico, and Arizona. And I think California was a part of the conversation as well. Basically, hey, Mexico, if you attack America and we all win this war together, we're going to give you back territory that was previously taken from you. This is a pretty good political cartoon that shows a German hand, okay, and the logo on the glove there is a distinctly German, the German Empire, trying to carve out some of the United States and promise it back to Mexico. So it looks like the California has proposed to maybe go to Japan. That's a little bit more detail than I'm going to get into right now. So all that to say, once the Zimmerman telegram was intercepted and published in American newspapers, that was it. The American public was now ready for war. Previously wanting to stay out of it, let's just mind our own business and let the Europeans, you know, chew each other up. We don't have to get involved. It's across the ocean. But the Zimmerman telegram is what actually draws the United States into war. Causes an outrage in America. You can see on your notes there. So if you were President Wilson, what would you do at this time? Stay isolated or get involved in the war? Let me see hands for stay isolated. It's not our problem. We intercepted the telegram so we can head off the problems. Maybe we'll just beef up our southern border security. Stay isolated, get involved in the war. Screw Germany. Fooey on you for trying to get Mexico involved. We're going to come to Europe and punish you now. All right, I got a bunch of warmongers here. Here's what Wilson says. This is a quote. Wilson says, the world must be made safe for democracy. Its peace must be planted upon the tested foundations of political liberty. Basically, he makes it a cause for democracy. He makes it not about punishment for Germany, not about revenge for the whole Zimmerman telegram and the Lusitania. But he says, we're going to get involved in the war because we got to make sure democracy wins and totalitarianism and dictatorship doesn't take over in Europe. So because of the Zimmerman telegram, Wilson takes his request for war to Congress, and Congress officially declares war on Germany in April of 1917. Of note, this note, I'm not going to, my bad, I was about to say the wrong thing. So, I'm making the point here. You see the words on the screen on purpose. The Lusitania contributed to the point that we would go to war, but it was not the reason. The reason was the Zimmerman telegram. It was much closer to the point that we actually declared war. It was actually the tipping point that drew America into war. So now the nation is at war, and there's a headline that says that. Leads to several things. This is a World War I draft card. So the draft card is something, you know, the draft is something that's in effect. Something else, this is pretty cool. This is called the slacker wagon. Every person, every man was supposed to go register for the draft, but some people didn't. So you know what the military did? They took this big old cattle car, right, just this open top, farm vehicle, and they started going around cities and saying, hey, you registered for the draft? You registered for the draft? No? Get in. It's called the slacker patrol. So some of you probably need a slacker patrol every now and then as well. Make sure you get all your work done in life. So this is it. America enters the war in total. Now I'm gonna peel back the war effort tomorrow. This is kind of jumping straight to the end here. In total, 2.8 million American doughboys are drafted into the armed forces. Doughboy is actually a kind of a derogatory nickname because what it means is you look really fresh. When the Americans got to the fight 2.5 years later, everyone who'd already been over there fighting for so long was like, hey, golly gee, thanks for coming to the party, you bunch of doughboys. Doughboy meant that they looked really clean and fresh-faced. So a bit of a derogatory term, but we kind of adopted it as our nickname anyway. So if you hear doughboy, that refers to an American soldier in World War I. So Europe had been fighting back and forth for a long time. Tomorrow we're really going to talk about trench warfare. We're going to see how ugly it was. when the Americans got there,
the war was over within a year.
I'm not saying we saved the day. I'm not giving us that American pat on the back. But I am saying we broke the stalemate that had been. The influx of two million Americans finally led to the war getting past, just struggling to stay, at the same level. The Americans coming in on the side of the Allies is what really broke open the war and eventually leads to the defeat of Germany and victory for the Allies in the first place. So that is cutting all the way to the end. But I haven't quite told you about the peace treaty and the resolution of the war. So that is still a couple days ahead of us for now. So, what are your questions? What is the thing that got America involved in the war? Primary reason?
Not the assassination.
What gets America involved in the war is the Zimmerman telegram. What kicks off the war in the first place, Delaney, right? In Europe, the immediate cause of the war is the assassination. So Zimmerman telegram, that's a big takeaway. That gets America involved in the war. M-A-I-N-N, what's the M?
Militarism.
What's the A?
Alliances.
What's the I?
Imperialism.
What's the N?
Nationalism.
And then what did I call the assassination? What's the IC?
Immediate
cause. Yeah, the actual thing that led to the war kicking off. The long buildup for MAIN, the immediate cause for the others. So, hey guys, thanks for paying attention today. Thanks for participating in my little skit. Hang on to these notes because you'll see that there's still blanks that we haven't rounded out yet. We are headed towards an immersive experience, and that is all I'm going to say about that. So keep coming back to school this week, even if you got, we're sliding into Thanksgiving. I hope you want to be here because we got a fun 3 days ahead of us. Friday is going to be really a big to-do, and I hope you'll be here for Friday. Here's what's going to happen next. You are going to go to your second block, but it is the advisory time schedule. And what you're going to do is a bus evacuation drill. If you're not going to advisory, you're going to your second block. Does that make sense? All right, go ahead, get tidy, get situated. Give me my bullets.
Julia, did I shoot one at you?
Hang on. You're going to pick up the bus?
Oh, yes. I will.